May we please move on to the next session for today? And that session is about role of echocardiography, clinical echo session case-based approach. And that session is sponsored by the unrestricted academic grant from the MacLeod Pharmaceuticals Limited. Can we have a
हमारी टॉक होनी है, ये तो एडवर्टाइजमेंट है ना कि पैसे।
थैंक यू फॉर द एवी एंड नाउ वी विल मूव ऑन टू द सेशन एंड फॉर दैट मे आई प्लीज रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर एच के चोपड़ा, डॉक्टर अंजुलाल दत्तू, डॉक्टर अशोक कुमार कौर, डॉक्टर कार्तिक गांगुली, Dr. Ashut Sarkar, Dr. Devanu Ghosh Roy, Dr. Shutra Banerjee, Dr. Deepak Ranjan Das, Dr. Gautam Dotto to join the session as chairperson. And our first speaker for this session is again Dr. Devika Chatterjee, and she will present her case, 70-year-old man with acute chest pain and significant MR on echo. Requesting again all the speakers to kindly restrict the presentation by the stipulated time, otherwise we will not have any time for this purpose.
Yes, at the outset, I must say that the previous session was a brilliant session. I want to compliment Anurag the day for the most outstanding session I'd ever seen, so-called a couplet session with multiple multimodality imaging. And I think now is another also very interesting session, role of echocardiography in clinical echo session. We have all eminent speakers, eminent presenters, and eminent chairperson for the session. The first speaker is Dr. Devika Chatterjee. She needs no introduction. I'll request her to start her presentation, complete in 8 minutes and 4 minutes for discussion. Dr. Devika Chatterjee, please.
Dr. Chopra, just as a clinician, if I am asked what is the diagnosis, let me make first diagnosis and see whether the final diagnosis, that will make the case interesting. It could, sure. It could be a case of acute coronary syndrome with papillary muscle dysfunction and MR.
Sure.
Thank you, sir. For the kind introduction and good evening, everybody. So I am going to present a case of acute chest pain with significant MR in this clinical echo session, where I'm going to show the role of echocardiography. My patient was a 70 years old man, hypertensive, non-diabetic, non-smoker. He stated that 2 days prior to the day of presentation, he had a severe substernal chest pain, which he never experienced in his lifetime. And on the day of presentation, he developed sudden onset severe shortness of breath. Now, on admission to our hospital, he was hemodynamically unstable with respiratory distress and hypotension, for which dobutamine infusion was started. And with 10 micrograms of dobutamine, he maintained his blood pressure at 90 by 60 millimeter of mercury. Heart rate 110 beat per minute, His respiratory rate was 25. He had elevated JVP. There was a systolic murmur at the apex radiating to axilla. And in the chest, he had bilateral crepitations. ECG showed evidence of inferior wall myocardial infarction. Cardiac enzyme was elevated. And chest X-ray showed evidence of bilateral pulmonary edema. Now, at this time, at this point of time, he developed cardiogenic shock for which he was intubated. So when transthoracic echocardiography was done, he was already been intubated. We couldn't turn the patient to the left lateral. Moreover, he was tachycardic. All these factors resulted in a very poor echo window with suboptimal echo images. However, we could make out that there is an akinesia in the inferior wall. If we look at the short axis, akinetic inferior wall, and all other walls were contracting vigorously. And in the apical four-chamber view, we have seen that LV cavity size is within normal limit with no wall motion abnormalities in the four-chamber view. However, the anterior mitral leaflet was looking flaky. Now, when we put the color flow, though the image quality was very, very poor, we could see that there is a significant eccentric jet of MR. This is the apical three-chamber view. And this is the MR which we could pick up. Now, since the image quality is very poor and it's very difficult to find out the exact cause of mitral regurgitation, because the sensitivity of transthoracic echo is only 65 to 85%, whereas that of transesophageal echocardiography is 92 to 100%. So we went for a transesophageal echo. So this is the mid esophageal four chamber view. This is LA, LV, RA, and RV. So what I saw that AML is flail with excessive motion and there is a coaptation failure of the leaflets. Now, as I changed my multiplanar angle to around 40 degree, I could clearly see a large mobile mass attached to the cordae of the flail AML. The mass was moving freely in the LA and LV along with the flail anteromitral leaflet. Now, this type of erratically and chaotically moving mobile mass attached to the cordae of unsupported flail mitral valve leaflet is a very specific sign of papillary muscle rupture. This has to be differentiated from caudal rupture because in caudal rupture, we don't see such mass attached to the ruptured cordae. Because it's only filamentous. Whereas here, what happens as soon as the papillary muscle ruptures, it gets entangled with the cordae and takes a roundish shape. So, so this is a case of papillary muscle rupture. And that papillary muscle rupture has resulted in significant eccentric wall hugging jet of mitral regurgitation. As we can see, this is the wall hugging jet. And any wall-hugging eccentric jet of MR has to be considered severe unless proven otherwise. And if we look at the direction of the MR jet, it's exactly the opposite to the flail leaflet. Since AML is flail, so the jet is directed posteriorly. Now, these type of MR, because of the papillary muscle rupture, is a life-threatening complication of acute myocardial infarction as happened in this case. And though it is very rare, but 50 to 70% of the patients die within 24 hours without surgical intervention.
Hey, 10 minute bola, 8 minute kar diya.
Hello, can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
So 50 to 70% patients die within 24 hours without surgical intervention. This is almost twice than the mortality rate of post-MI ventricular septal rupture. So an early diagnosis and prompt surgical intervention is needed to save the life of the patient. Now, if we look at the mid-esophageal views, we can only visualize the ruptured head, as you can see, which is attached to the cordae. We really can't visualize the ruptured stump or the residual stump attached to the LV. It is in the transgastric view, especially the two-chamber view, where we can really see the ruptured head as well as the residual ruptured stump of the papillary muscle. As you can see here, this is the cutoff of the papillary muscle. This end is attached to the cordy, and this is the residual stump, which is attached to the LV wall. Now, as we know, there are two sets of papillary muscle.
Where to conclude? Be a little fast.
Okay. Anterolateral and posterior medial, both send cordy to both the AML and PML to maintain the stress, maintain the tension throughout the systole, which is vital for the mitral valve competence. And when and the rupture of the posterior medial papillary muscle is three times more common than anterolateral because of the single blood supply of the posterior medial, whereas anterolateral gets dual blood supply. And rupture may be complete or partial. Whether it's partial or complete, the papillary muscle rupture usually occurs 2 to 7 days after the acute MI, commonly inferior wall MI, usually along with the fast attack of MI. And the infarct size is usually small, and that results in absent severe wall motion abnormality. As you can see, LV is hyperdynamic, so this preserved contractility exerts high shear forces to already ischemic papillary muscle. Eventually, the rupture occurs, resulting in acute MR, which is a cardiac emergency because of sudden volume and the pressure overload on the unprepared LA and LV, resulting in increased stroke work, increased filling LV filling pressure, increased LA pressure, resulting in acute pulmonary edema. In addition, there is a fall
of Please conclude.
Yeah, so a CAG was done, and in the operation table, it was found to be a case of rupture of papillary muscle. A MBR was done, and along with the CABG. So to conclude, I would say the role of ECHO in such a patient of chest pain and significant MR is multiple. It not only identify the exact location and extension of MI, also it identifies severity of an acute nature of mitral regurgitation. Most importantly, a quick identification of the exact cause of the MR, because the outcome of the treatment depends on the rapidity of diagnosis, which we could do. And within 24 hours, a surgical intervention was done, which gave us a very, very favorable prognosis. And patient went home with uneventful recovery. Thank you.
Just two questions, Devika. Number one is, yes, how quick and how early you were to do an echo of this patient to diagnose this? And number two, what's the message for clinical echo people as to how fast they should do? What should be the modality? What's the message of your presentation?
Yes, sir. So the patient, as I said, came in the cardiogenic shock. We tried for transthoracic echo, and the patient was intubated by that time. So we were ready with the transesophageal echo. Quickly, we did the transesophageal echo. So within almost an hour or 1.5 hours, the diagnosis was complete. So, and patient had to be, we had to insert the IABP also. So the coronary angiogram was done with IABP. The message is, like, if you see a flail AML, flail mitral valve leaflet, and the murmur intensity might not be very, very loud, even it may be, you know, less loud because of the equalization of the pressure of LA and LV. So if you see a flail AML with a mass, go for papillary muscle rupture diagnosis so that we can move very fast, fast coronary angiogram and a surgical intervention without 24 hours is needed.
I think it's a very brilliant message. Don't see only flail well as a diagnosis. What is the cause of flail should be investigated. Very well presentation. Any question by any of the co-chairpersons? Anjana Datta?
It is very common to have posterior papillary muscle ruptured in inferior wall MI because posterior muscle is large and single supply blood.
Yes, I've shown it.
So I think...
Can I ask one question?
Yes, please. Yes, go ahead.
Yes. We have also seen a similar case. So if we get a soft systolic murmur in the mitral area, in an infarct, we do echocardiography. In our patient with ventilator, we did angio and subsequently MVR and coronary artery bypass. So time is the crux. So as early as possible, whatever may be papillary muscle rupture or it may be corticotendinitis rupture, it needs surgery with bypass.
So timely approach, immediate action, and pinpoint the diagnosis. Right. I think everything is covered by Deepika. You must give us a big hand to Deepika for her outstanding presentation. Thank you. I hand over to Anjali Datta for the next presenter introduction and the subject. Dr. Datta, sir.
You please carry on, Dr. Chopra. All the materials are with you.
Okay, the next session is also very important. And we are a very eminent person, called as a father of cardiography, Dr. S.K. Parashar. And the topic is very interesting. And I think it's a 50-year-old guy with a furious arrhythmias. And I'll request Dr. Parashar to have his presentation with Director RV. Dr. Parashar, sir.
Can you hear me, please?
Yes, we can hear you, sir.
Actually, initially we were asked to give the talk in about 10 minutes time, but nowadays we reduced to 8 minutes, so I have to skip a lot of slides. So the topic given was a 50-year-old female with a fast, furious arrhythmia and RV enlargement. So whenever we get an arrhythmia from, where is my slide? So whenever we get arrhythmias from RV, the few possibilities we come is ARVD, a Brugada syndrome, which is usually no structural abnormality, but mainly an ECG syndrome, RVOTVT, again, which has got no structural heart disease, operated fellow tetralogy, especially those patients who have undergone a pulmonary wall replacement with severe PR, they can present with malignant arrhythmias. But as we stand today with a fast furious arrhythmia with RV enlargement, this arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia or the cardiomyopathy comes as the first diagnosis. Now, the current...
We can't see the pictures. We don't see the pictures here. Any presentation?
Sir, can you share your screen?
Can you see the picture?
No, we don't see anything here.
We haven't shared it.
No, but I don't know because I have already shared the screen.
No, it's not come, sir.
We don't see any pictures, only your voice is audible.
You go share screen, you press share screen. You click share screen.
Just a minute. Isko to zero pe lana hoga na pehle. Aye, share screen, I am.
Nahi sir, ek baar pehle dekhiye, desktop mein hai.
Can you see now?
Yeah. Now
it's okay. Now it's okay. Go ahead. Yes, sir.
Go to the phone. Yeah, fine.
So now we have to again. So whenever we get an arrhythmia from RV, there are many possibilities. As I told you, the few ones are low. But the most common one with a fast furious arrhythmia with RV enlargement is this group of patients. Now, the current terminology has changed. Previously, we used to call it arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. But now the current terminology is arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy because it is not restricted to RV only, but also isolated LV arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy and balanced biventricular cardiomyopathy in which both the ventricles are involved, but one more than the other. So that now the current terminology should be an arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, although the right ventricle is more common. Now, as you know, this is a progressive disease, a segmental replacement of an RV myocardium with a fibrofatty tissue in specific areas. And this fibrofatty tissue leads to the presence of a ventricular arrhythmias. Now, there are three stages of ARVC. Luckily, we had the chance of getting all the three stages with us, but I think because of shortage of time, we'll only show a few of them. For example, an early concealed phase in which there is only a risk of a sudden cardiac death on exertion. And then there is a classical electrical phase, which we call an ARVD. Now coming to the first phase, this was a 22-year-old male, asymptomatic completely. A routine ECG for a medical examination showed a T-wave inversion all relevant tests were normal, and echo was done. After echo, he put a very direct question to me, should I get married, which is being considered? We did not know why he is asking it, but that was his only question after echo. And what in echo we found that everything looked all right, but the right ventricle looked a bit suspicious or a bit enlarged or so. Then in a short access view, the RVOT appeared enlarged, but RV functions were normal. Then there was some suspicion of a trabeculation in the RV, and a modified right ventricular view showed a prominent this trabeculi here. So, but the RV functions was normal. So we got an MRI done, because this was done almost about 8-9 years back. They wrote a mild hypokinesia of RV, RVOT enlarged, RVEF decreased, but in the end they wrote a no non-compaction of ARVD, which did not go with our diagnosis, which we had put this MRI. But then later on, the next history, why the patient asked this question was, his younger brother died suddenly at the age of 32 years. So this gave us a diagnosis that yes, we were correct, and he was in a concealed phase of an RV cardiomyopathy presenting with RV dilatation and ejection fraction, decreased ejection fraction. So that is when one must keep in mind these possibilities when you have got a clinical syndrome like this. Then the next is an overt electrical phase or a symptomatic arrhythmias. This was a 40-year-old patient admitted with a recent history of syncope. ECG revealed a ventricular tachycardia. So with a history of syncope, young individual, the possibility of ARVD came into our mind. And luckily, this patient had all the classical signs which are described in literature, like an RV dilatation, more marked in RV apex region or so. So you can see the RV is enlarged in this patient. Then there was a localized thinning of the right ventricle. You see a subcostal view because the myocardium has been replaced by a fibrofatty tissue. So there is a localized thinning of the myocardium, as you can see, of the right ventricle from a subcostal view. And in the same view, you see a lot of trabeculations present in the right ventricle. Third thing we can see, the segmental outpouchings are seen, which you can see in a modified view. This is the right ventricle, and you see a segmental outpouching because of a systolic strain on a thin myocardium. Then we can see a localized RV aneurysm. So all these classical findings are seen in the RVOD, and this aneurysm formation is because of the variable areas of fibrosis and scarring. And here you see again a subcostal view, there is a sort of an aneurysmal dilatation of the right ventricle, all again giving us a supporting the diagnosis of arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. A hyperreflective moderator band has been described in about 34% of patients or so. And here you see a hyperreflective moderator band present, which is also a sign of a ARVD. Then a excessive trabeculation, which we have shown you, can also be seen in other views also, so that all the classical signs are seen. And then RV function, of course, that was a time about 8-9 years back when we were more seeing the TAPSE and the RV TDI both showed a decrease in the RV functions. In the newer methods, now we have got 3D echo, which we can see a better RV volume and function and help in early diagnosis and the tissue deformation imaging. For example, once you see it, you can see a decrease in the RV ejection fraction in patients in these such patients, and they have got a sort of a good extra sort of a diagnostic feature in early cases and RV of this. And CMR, of course, is a highly sensitive tool and should be performed in all cases. Lastly, a diffuse phase known as a biventricular failure, a 65-year-old male, completely asymptomatic, occasional palpitations, which were later on found to be of a ventricular origin. And here you see, very rarely you see such situations, RV markedly dilated, very poorly contracting. LV shows a very poor contracting, indicating a biventricular involvement. And again, you see a predominantly right ventricle involvement with a papillary muscle dysfunction, RV, RA, and LAS, and the LV functions also very poorly, poorly functioning in these situations. And of course, if you see this carefully, you can see a epsilon wave also present in this situation. You can see a notch in the QRS complex before the T wave. This epsilon wave was present with an associated RV thrombus also. And again, you see, this is how a epsilon wave looks like. And you can see again an epsilon wave, so that when you get a fast furious arrhythmia associated with the RV enlargement, besides other possibilities, also keep an ARVD and ARVC in mind, and you see all possible views you can see, and then you can get a diagnosis of this. Thank you so much. Try to finish in about 8 minutes time instead of 10 minutes. Thank you.
I have a question, just sir. Can I ask a question, a comment rather?
Sure.
Sir, last week, a paper, nice paper came in JACC Imaging. There they show that as you rightly mentioned, that RV strain, and they use a RV mechanical dispersion, and these two combinations can very nicely predict ventricular arrhythmia vis-a-vis cardiac MI.
That to early stage, so what we have presented is what we can do. Say, for example, the two additions, what we have done is a 3D echo and a 2D strain imaging. But there are other features are also being produced also, which are mainly focused on the arrhythmias also. So our possibility was that suppose a patient comes with a, when we say fast, a furious arrhythmia, it means usually a ventricular fault of a thing. So what are the possibilities which we should keep in mind, and how to go and see every aspect, not forgetting the 3D. And there were certain limitations of the 2010 task force diagnosis also. So what we have concentrated is mainly on the diagnostic aspects, but your point is well taken. To show the arrhythmia, we can show a mechanical dispersion also.
I'd just like to make a comment. I think although comparatively less common, in fact rare, still we may have to consider isolated right ventricular cardiomyopathy. So that's dilated cardiomyopathy. That's a variety which really is a cardiomyopathy, a dilated cardiomyopathy, but doesn't really involve the left atria, the left ventricle. So that has a familial occurrence as well. So maybe
dilated cardiomyopathy comes in the differential diagnosis also, but in a dilated, this isolated right ventricular cardiomyopathy, the diagnosis of an arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy is now referred to as a right ventricular cardiomyopathy. It is because it is now all the chambers may be involved. So ARVD, and also a slightly older term, we are now calling as an arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy of the RV type. A dilated cardiomyopathy usually involves both the right and the left ventricles, and left ventricles more as compared to the right ventricle. And though the arrhythmias are seen in that, but so not so common to see a history of syncope, sudden death, fast furious arrhythmias. So dilated cardiomyopathy does come. Even sometimes rarely a right-sided sarcoidosis has also been kept as a possibility. But the most common possibility in such a situation is always a right-sided cardiomyopathy.
My next question to you, Dr. Parashar, how common are thrombi and pulmonary embolism in these patients? And what was your advice when the patient came to you, should I marry or not?
Sir, that is that once later on. So because he told me later on, then when we got an MRI, we called him a second time. Then we did not give him a very sort of a very direct answer. We invariably told him to hold on for some time and see. And then when you get these patients, because they have got a very poor functions of the heart, it is always advisable maybe to give them some anticoagulants to prevent any thrombus. For example, one patient we had who had a right ventricular thrombi. So it is always like any sort of a cardiomyopathy or a poor LV functions or RV function, they may help in this prevention of the various thrombotic lesions or so. So ultimately, this patient, we told him to hold on for some time before deciding about the marriage, because he was testing us. He never told us that his brother died at a very young age or so. And then
the difference in the cardiomyopathy is the basic factor that is differentiating it from other cardiomyopathy is the fatty infiltration and degeneration. That is the root cause of arrhythmia.
That is the cause of arrhythmia. And because it is a focal disease, so now the role of endomyocardial biopsy is very limited. Because in endomyocardial biopsy, we take the septal tissue, which is not involved in these cases. And as you rightly said, it is a fibrofatty. It is not only the fibrofatty, it is only fibrofatty tissue, which is a substrate for arrhythmias. I agree with you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your brilliant presentation. With this, we go to the next case now by Dr. Vivek Tandon. He's talking on cardiac arrest and a systolic murmur. Dr. Tandon, please.
Good evening, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah. Please go ahead.
And are my slides visible?
Yeah. Visible.
Okay. So I was asked in this clinico echo session, case-based approach, I was asked to present the case of a 38-year-old man with a history of presumed cardiac arrest and a systolic murmur on auscultation. This patient was normotensive, non-diabetic. He had one episode of observed loss of consciousness while he was in the sitting position, which was preceded by a sudden onset of palpitation, no other warning symptoms. He had a spontaneous recovery and there was no seizure reported during this episode. It was a very brief episode, but a relative observed it and described it. No other significant history could be elicited. On examination, the only positive findings were that there was occasional irregularity in the pulse and there was a systolic murmur grade 3/6. And negative findings, there was no neurological deficit and there were no other relevant findings on clinical examination. So given the history of loss of consciousness and the irregularity of the pulse and systolic murmur, of course, the patient was advised an ECG, which showed one ventricular ectopic was captured in the ECG. Otherwise, it was essentially normal. X-ray chest was also essentially normal. Holter, on the other hand, revealed that 4.5% of all recorded beats were ventricular ectopics. And out of these ventricular ectopics, there were two short non-sustained ventricular runs of 4 beats each. The ventricular ectopics which were recorded were pleomorphic. There were several couplets also. This was one of the runs of non-sustained VT which was recorded. So something's going on in the heart, of course. And the echo revealed significant thickening and prolapse of the mitral valve by a leaflet prolapse with a significant mitral regurgitation. And something peculiar is happening here, if you'll pay attention to that, and we'll see it better in other views. This is a modified pastern long axis view, almost an apical three-chamber view, so-called, or long axis view. And we see a distinct separation between the mitral annulus and the wall of the left ventricle. This is also visible in this apical four-chamber view. And of course, we can see the mitral valve collapse very well here. And here in the still frame, we see that separation between the mitral annulus and the LV wall very clearly. And in fact, an ectopic has been captured in this also. This is another patient with a mitral valve collapse with a little bit of MR, where we don't see that feature which we saw in the case which we are presenting. So mitral valve collapse is present in 1 to 3% of the population. We all know the definition. It is generally regarded as a benign condition, but the outcome is widely heterogeneous. And since the 1980s, several complications have been reported, including progressive MR, atrial fibrillation, strokes in sinus rhythm, CHF, infective endocarditis, ventricular arrhythmias, and even sudden cardiac death. So a term has been coined, arrhythmic mitral valve collapse, and there is an increasing awareness of the association between mitral valve collapse and sudden cardiac death. Several clinical risk factors which are associated with increased risk of MVP-related SCD have been elucidated. Most of them can be evaluated by non-invasive diagnostic modalities. It is more common in young females. ECG tends to show biphasic or inverted T waves in inferior leads. Often we find complex ventricular ectopy. There is a spiked configuration of the lateral annular mitral annular velocities by echo, the Pickle-Hobby sign, which I will show in detail a little in the next slide. Mitral annulus disjunction, which we have seen in the 2D echo. The severity of the mitral annulus disjunction is associated with the ventricular arrhythmia burden. And evidence of myocardial fibrosis by cardiac MR in the LV papillary muscle and in the inferobasal segments of the LV. Two important echo signs for MVP and risk of malignant arrhythmias are mitral annular disjunction, which is defined as a detachment of the roots of the annulus from the ventricular myocardium, producing a gap of 2 to 10 millimeters, sometimes more during systole, typical under P1 and P2 scallops, and the Pickle-Hobby sign, which is a high velocity bit systolic spike in the tissue Doppler velocity profile of the lateral mitral annulus. And this velocity usually exceeds 16 centimeters per second. These two features, mitral annulus disjunction and the accompanying MVP, generally eventually lead to fibrosis of the papillary muscle and the inferobasal myocardium, which can act as a substrate for ventricular arrhythmias. So this is an example from a journal of the Pickle-Hobby sign. This is the medial mitral annular velocity. See the systolic velocity, it's smooth with a rise and fall. This is in the lateral annulus where you see the velocity starts to increase and then suddenly in mid-systole there's a rapid increase up to a peak of about 20 centimeters per second and then a decline. And this was thought to resemble these spiked helmets which were worn by German soldiers in World War I, which was called a Pickle-Hobby. So what do we do in arrhythmic mitral valve collapse? Additional workup could include EPS, loop recorder implant for long-term rhythm monitoring. Possible management strategies, not clear, but low-risk MVP patients may undergo surveillance cardiac monitoring, beta blockers, and be told to avoid stimulants such as caffeine, alcohol, or tobacco. Catheter ablation may be attempted if electrical triggers for the VT-EVF can be mapped and identified, or for scar-related reentrant ventricular tachycardia. For mitral valve surgery, there is very limited literature. It may be useful in younger patients before the fibrosis becomes too extensive, and surgical cryoablation may be added during the mitral valve surgery. The use of AICD, again, there are no studies which have proved whether it is helpful for primary prevention or secondary prevention. There's no randomized evidence for that. And it seems logical that in patients where you have had recovery from an episode of SCD, it would prove useful. And just to emphasize the findings, this is an 18-year-old male who was evaluated for an irregular pulse. There were pleomorphic Vs on ECG Holter. Elsewhere, the transthoracic echo diagnosed MVP. When we did the echo, we found there was MVP with trace MR, but we also found or described mitral annular disjunction and the Pickle-Hobby sign. So this is the plaques view where we can see a little bit of prolapse, a little bit of MR. But if you look at the region of the mitral annulus, we can see the mitral annulus disjunction very clearly. Here is a still frame showing that it is about 11 millimeters. The separation between the mitral annulus and the LV myocardium. This is not the classic Pickle-Hobby sign which we found in the journal, but yes, there is distinctly and a very high systolic velocity in the actual mitral annulus. Thank you. So that concludes my presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Tandon. It was a fantastic case reporting because many a times we are happy to diagnose a mitral annular mitral valve prolapse to explain for the arrhythmias that we come across. Although we know that very rarely mitral valve prolapse leading to arrhythmia can result in cardiac arrest or cardiac death very rarely, but we didn't try to find out, or we didn't know who are the patients who are more likely to get a fatal cardiac arrest. Now that we find that there is a structural abnormality which is responsible for this extra risk of mitral valve prolapse. So what is your final call about the treatment?
So as I said, there is no definite evidence. There are no long-term studies. So I would guess that one strategy would be to do an electrophysiological study, and if a trigger can be found for the ventricular arrhythmias, to do an ablation there. If no trigger can be found and there is documented sudden cardiac death, then perhaps an AICD would be useful. The other option is that, especially if there is a significant regurgitation, which could likely increase and lead to failure, and if it is caught early enough, then maybe mitral valve surgery would be helpful. And if prior to the surgery, if an electrophysiological study can document ventricular arrhythmia trigger, then as I mentioned in my case report and the study after that, it may be cryoablation during the surgery of the trigger point for the arrhythmia would be useful. So these are all strategies which are, yes, sir.
Vivek, I think it was a brilliant presentation, but I have a very important comment to make. I had a privilege of working with Perloff, and I've seen a lot of mitral valve prolapse, and they have a very significant dysautonomia. And that's how the role of beta blocker has to be considered very, very seriously, and they have to be effectively treated. You mentioned about mitral annular disengagement. That's a very, very important point. But mitral valve prolapse has got a very, very strong association with autonomic dysautonomia, and its triggering is usually anxiety and stress. And I think yes, the beta blocker dose should be thoroughly titrated, as pointed out by Dr. Anjalal Datta. Even yes, after intervention also, they are prone to get a recurrence. We'd like to have your comment on this, Vivek.
Quite right, sir. I mentioned as the first point in the management strategy, that beta blockers can be very useful. And of course, they will help to control the dysautonomia. And besides that, the patient should, of course, avoid any stimulants such as caffeine or alcohol or any illicit drugs which can increase the sympathetic activity.
What is your final message, Vivek, for every one of us who see mitral prolapse quite often?
I would say that in every case of mitral valve prolapse, now we should be alert for these two one echocardiographic warnings, which can tell us that these patients might be prone to arrhythmias in the future if they have not already developed them. And we should keep following them up on a more regular basis than patients who don't have these signs on echo and who do have mitral valve prolapse.
Look for the gap so that there is no knowledge gap.
I think it was a brilliant presentation, sir. And the message is very clear. Every mitral valve prolapse should be considered seriously, because the mitral regurgitation in mitral valve prolapse is highly labile. You may see grade 1 at one time, and at times the same mitral valve prolapse will have a grade 4. And I think the arrhythmias are very, very common. Very nice message, and we must compliment Dr. Vivek Tandon.
Yes, sir. Yes.
With this, we'll come to the next case now. The next case is by a very eminent echocardiologist of India, Professor R. Elagesan. Echo after a blunt injury of the chest. Professor Elagesan, sir.
Good evening, Dr. Chopra. Thank you for introducing me. And thank Dr. Anuradha Day for inviting me to present this case. So only thing is, this is not a 24-year-old, but a 4-year-old boy who had a trauma about 1 month back. I am presenting two cases, one of trauma and another one, an interesting case. So this boy was actually riding with his grandfather in a bike, in a motorbike. And when the motorbike hit against a car, he was thrown away and he had a blunt trauma. So this 5-year-old boy was admitted with severe left heart failure and was stabilized with the usual treatment. He was fairly stable, and the patient was able to lie down when we did the echocardiogram. So this is the echocardiogram, which clearly shows that there is a severe mitral regurgitation. There is a flail anterior mitral leaflet, and you can here see the rupture of the papillary muscle. So this patient has got a blunt trauma, which has resulted in the rupture of the papillary muscle, with the flail anterior mitral leaflet and a severe mitral regurgitation. These are the other echocardiographic views, which you can see. This is a short axis view at the level of the mitral valve, which is normal. At the level of the papillary muscle, you can see the the detachment of the papillary muscle. Here, there is some dissection of the left ventricular muscle also. And the short axis view at the level of the aortic valve, the LA is dilated. And this shows again the mitral regurgitation, which is central in this patient. And the inferior vena cava was normal, so the patient was not in cardiac failure. And these are the four chamber view, which again shows the mitral regurgitation. And these are the two chamber views, which again shows the ruptured papillary muscle. Okay. And these are the subcostal views. In the subcostal view, you can clearly see there is a rupture of the papillary muscle. And there is some tear in the left ventricular posterior wall muscle also. The muscle also has got torn. So this is a patient, a blunt trauma resulting in severe mitral regurgitation due to the rupture or avulsion of the papillary muscle along with some tear in the left ventricular posterior wall musculature. And the right ventricular pressures, the mildly it was elevated, the TR gradient was about 35 millimeters of mercury. Say, coming to the blunt chest trauma, it can result in contusion of the myocardium, ventricular dysfunction, and arrhythmia. Sometimes you can get a ventricular arrhythmia, it is called commotio cardis. You can get aortic transection, then valvular injuries. Being the aortic valve, which is very superficial, which is the commonest one to get injured. The mitral valve injury is next common, and tricuspid pulmonary valve injury has been reported. The aortic valve injury surprisingly occurs when the trauma is during the early diastole, that is during the isovolemic relaxation period, whereas the mitral valve injury occurs when the trauma occurs during late diastole and end systole, especially during the isovolemic contraction phase. So the aortic valve injury is during the isovolemic relaxation phase, and the mitral valve injury occurs during the isovolemic contraction phase. This second patient is another patient with, who has come with severe chest pain. So if you see the echocardiogram, this is the continuous wave Doppler across the left ventricular outflow tract. Surprising. See, this is usually an aortic regurgitation is pan-diastolic. This patient has got an early diastolic aortic regurgitation. The aortic regurgitation is absent during the mid and late diastolic. So this is the only case where we have seen only early diastolic aortic regurgitation. We'll see what is the cause. So this is actually another patient who had a severe mitral regurgitation, mild aortic regurgitation. You can see even in mild aortic regurgitation, the aortic regurgitation is pan-diastolic. This is another patient with a moderate aortic regurgitation. You can see the dense envelope of aortic regurgitation with a normal blood pressure half-time. And this is another patient with aortic valve vegetations and severe aortic regurgitation. You can again see there is a pan-diastolic aortic regurgitation with a reduced pressure half-time of less than 250 milliseconds. Whereas this patient, this is another patient in whom there are ventricular premature beats. You can here see that the patient has got systolic aortic regurgitation. So this is a beat with the compensatory pass. You get a systolic aortic regurgitation. This is another beat with an interpolated ventricular ectopic. Then you get the systolic aortic regurgitation. And this is from the literature. You can see there is a pan-systolic and a pan-diastolic regurgitation. This can happen only when there is a left ventricular assist device which is placed in the left ventricle. And there is an aortic regurgitation. This can result in significant aortic runoff. And when there is significant aortic regurgitation, the aortic valve has to be sutured when you are doing the left ventricular assist device. So this patient is in a early diastolic aortic regurgitation. What is the cause? So this is the two-dimensional echocardiogram, which is not very remarkable. And here you can see the apical four-chamber view, two-chamber view, it is normal. Here in the apical long axis view, you can see apart from the aortic valve, there is a thick echo, which is coming and closing the mitral valve. And if you see the aortic regurgitation, this thick tissue blocks the aortic regurgitation during mid-late diastole. So that's why the aortic regurgitation was present. The picture was not quite good. We are not able to clearly show the dilatation as an aortic dissection. But if you can see here, that this is the arch of the aorta where you can see the dissection flap. And this is the abdominal aorta where you can see the dissection flap. So this is a patient with dissection of the aorta with the flap closing the aortic valve during mid-late diastole, resulting in only an early diastolic aortic regurgitation. So these are two interesting cases which I wanted to present. The first one is due to trauma. The second one was spontaneous aortic dissection in an older patient. Thank you.
Brilliant presentation of both spontaneous in an old man and a young boy. My only question is for a young boy, what is you think is the natural history of this mitral regurgitation, which is produced by the blunt injury over the chest?
This requests surgery as early as possible. In this patient, the surgery is an urgent one. So this patient has been stabilized and this patient needs a surgery.
You mentioned, sir, this is usually due to contusion or the injury of the myocardium. Anytime, any report that there is a vascular injury in the myocardium?
No. The valve injury is not due to the contusion of the myocardium. I mentioned the different types of injury which can happen to the, heart. But there are other injuries also. You can get injuries of the chest wall. We can get injury to the lung. You can get injury to the abdominal organs like that. So we are mainly focusing on the injury to the heart. The cardiac injury can be in the form of contusion of the myocardium. That can be rupture of any of the chambers of the myocardium. And you can get, tear and the blood vessels which are coming out of the heart. There can be tear which are going to the blood vessels which are going inside the heart, the veins, superior inferior vena cava, and the pulmonary veins. And also we can get injury to the valves. Among the valve injuries, aortic valve injury is the most common one. Mitral valve comes next. And the literature says the aortic valve injury is common when the chest hits against the blunt object during isovolemic relaxation, and the mitral valve injury during isovolemic contraction phase.
The interesting aspect is that when you have a injury of the avulsion of the mitral valve or aortic valve, surprisingly, there is no injury mark on the myocardium itself, either in the inner surface or outer surface. Yes. So this injury is, to a certain extent, it's slightly difficult to explain. That you don't have any direct trauma, but the trauma is indirect. Otherwise, that would have been injury in the muscle and the left ventricle or right ventricle.
Yes, Dr. Elagesan, any final comment? Dr. Elagesan, any message you want to give?
Any patient with blunt trauma, we have to look for abnormalities of the myocardium. We can get, edema of the myocardium, you can get tear in the myocardium, etc. This is a blunt trauma. The other one is the sharp, penetrating trauma, which is completely different one.
Thank you very much, sir, for your brilliant presentation.
Can I comment one thing, sir?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah. In a blunt injury, yes, sir. So what is said, the aortic valve is common in the mitral valve. And the tricuspid valve is less uncommon. But important point about the tricuspid valve is that it presents so late. It may not be evident even now. Because I have two cases where there is a blunt chest trauma. The immediate injury was, immediate echo was not done. The patient was totally asymptomatic. After 5 years, somebody recorded up. He came with a certain dyspnea and the right-sided heart failure, and it was found it's a case of avulsion of the total tricuspid valve and this papillomavulsion. So tricuspid valve is a very late presentation.
This is because most probably the tricuspid regurgitation is usually very well tolerated by...
Agreed.
Whereas the left ventricle doesn't tolerate the mitral regurgitation.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you very much, sir. I think it was the most lucid presentation, very informative, and I'm sure it will go a long way. Now we have the last presentation of the evening, Dr. Satish Govind. He'll be talking on shock after CABG. Dr. Satish Govind, sir.
Thank you, sir. This is about what happens post-operatively in the ITU. This is a patient which happened this last week, and it's a 67-year-old female who had comorbidities of diabetes, hypertension, and admitted earlier with acute coronary syndrome, and she was stabilized and she was okay. And then subsequently she had a coronary angiogram, and based on that, she had triple vessel disease, and she was considered for CABG. And this is how the pre-CABG, the parameters looked like. She was in sinus rhythm, and she had an acceptable BP, systemic examination unremarkable. Blood was essentially okay, except for mild increase in the sugars and dyslipidemia. And echo showed multiple wall motion abnormalities and significant LV dysfunction. And the chest X-ray again, here not showing much, unremarkable here. And the ECG shows sinus rhythm with STP changes. These were the early ECGs, and later on the serial ECG showed the deepening of the T inversions, but beyond that, there was nothing much. The coronary angiogram showed a type 3 vessel with proximal and mid involvement up to 80 to 94% stenosis. And she also had diagnosed with the diffuse disease up to 90%, non-dominant circumflex with 70% stenosis, and marginals were totally stenosis. And she had a dominant RCA with the mid 80% stenosis, and a PDA which was diffuse. So generally a very sort of diffuse disease, bad scenario, poor LV. Surgery was done once she was stable, and it was an elective CABG, and it was an off-pump CABG, and she underwent grafts for two vessels, one to Lima, which was to the LAD, and then the other one was the venous graft to the OM. And the surgeon also went ahead and did an OM endarterectomy. So the surgery per se was uneventful. Now, in the post-op ITU, she was wheeled in, and she was okay. The BP was slightly on the lower side, but tachycardic, and then she was on ventilator with a PEEP of 7 on inotropes. And some hours later, so they started to notice that she was developing some ectopics, and then BP started to go down somewhere at around 7th hour or so approximately. And then the BP persistently started to be low, and then they re-looked at hemodynamics, looked at the volumes, and then they reviewed the fluid. CVP was a little on the higher side, so fluid was not much of an issue. Inotropes were increased. At the same time, immediately, and echo was passed, and this was the echo. Now, generally, in a patient with immediate cardiac surgery, it's always difficult windows, and sometimes we've even had the extremes of where you don't see, hardly see anything. But this was one of the better patients where the window was quite good, and had to go a little extreme almost to the mid axillary. And what really struck was the immediate attention was on the pericardial effusion, which is prominent. And of course, the LV function was decreased. And the four chamber was reasonably okay. And what really sort of brings to your attention is the RV. So one can see that the RV, generally the contour is outward. So here, what is seen is a small dimple over here. So that means suggesting that there is some chamber compression here from the pericardial side. And this is causing the problem. And you can also see that the effusion is diffuse with in between a lot of strands, and particles were there. Now, these are the frozen images. So this is in diastole. You can make out the compression of the RV, RV distal free wall here. So this small area. So fortunately, this patient had good windows, but many a times we have seen that though the clinical presentation is in favor of hematoma or a clot which is compressing, we are unable to sort of locate it. But this was one of the better patients where it was better seen. And this again, looking at the RV with the diastolic compression, and then this is the LA, which is showing some compression during systole. So this is both the RV and the RA, which is showing chamber compression. And of course, the inflow variations were there, both the mitral as well as the tricuspid. The LV outflow is okay, nothing over there. And these patients with post-op also, the subcostal is almost extremely difficult. So what I do is I go towards the side. I may not be the ideal way of looking at the IVC because you're going a little deeper, but still you get a fair idea. So here, to some extent, one was able to see the IVC, which was mildly dilated and non-collapse. So everything sort of pointed in favor of a cardiac tamponade with a clot, which was compressing the RV, and she was taken to surgery and the bleeder was stopped and the clots were removed. So generally, when we have to look at the hemodynamic instability in such patients who have undergone bypass, it is always sort of as much as possible to gather information. So those with a higher sort of likelihood to have hemodynamic instability post CABG are those who had a pre-assessment where the EF was low, especially less than 25%. And there was also preoperative hemodynamic instability. So these are the patients likely to give problems, and also recent MI within the last 1 month, less than 1 month. Perioperatively, those who are likely to have hemodynamic instability are those who have prolonged CPB and also prolonged cross-clamp aortic times. And then those who also have on-table MI. So these are the high-risk patients who are likely to have hemodynamic instability. Now, once they are sort of in the ITU post, it is always a question of what is causing the hemodynamic instability. So is it the pump or is it the low SVR? So if you look at the cardiac output, if it is normal, if the cardiac index is, if it is low, then it is likely to be a pump problem. So one has to look at the rhythm. Usually the AF is the culprit. And also to look at for any low preloads or fluid challenge would be the best one. And also to look at review in the PP, in case if the PEEP needs to be decreased. And apart from the volume, apart from the rhythm, is it because of any contractility issues? Is there any graft problem, a spasm or acute graft failure, which is very, very less, but again, it has to be considered. And then again, the low pre-op EF where the poor inotropy is going to be the cause. And also afterload high, because of vasoconstriction, the dilators are started and then suddenly you have a drop in blood pressure. And that is when again, the BP can drop. And tamponade is the biggest culprit. And this is what was seen in our patient. If the index and the output is normal, so that means that there's no pump problem. So then one has to look at other possibilities. So inflammatory effects, especially in the CPB patients. And there's also likelihood of sepsis low, but still possible because of the vasodilation. There is a stagnation of the blood and it is susceptible to the bacteria, which is likely to be there if in some patients. Or could it be due to anaphylaxis, possible again, drug-induced hypertension. Is there anything to do with the adrenals, steroids related, neurogenic or the spinal shock and thyroid? Less likely, but again, to be kept in mind in terms of hyper and hypothyroid. So bleeding, when one looks into a possible bleeding, if it is a cause for hypertension, so is it medical versus surgical? So medical usually is due to the heparin effect, a prolonged heparin effect. And then of course, please, the treatment effects in the CPB.
Govind, please conclude.
Almost finished, sir. Clotting factor defects also there. And the surgical, it is a normal coagulation profile. And especially when they have a sudden increase in the drains, which is more than 500 ml, and also following sudden increase in BP. So CPB, you have these areas where you can have the vasodilator or the distributive shock. And then you have the reduced SVR, and that's how it is seen. And then the altered platelet functions also, which causes bleeding. So in terms of women, especially because the title was women, so there is no sort of immediate issues when it comes to women. It's more of mortality long-term, so nothing related to this patient. So the message is sudden drop in BP, immediate post-CABG. The first likelihood one should keep in mind is a tamponade and especially a clot formation with the drains blocking, and then drop in LVRV function, any new RWMA, mechanical complications like an MR, which has worsened. And if there's a problem in terms of visualization, one needs to look at T and also contrast to get better endocardial definition. Thanks. That's it.
thank you, Dr. Govind. What do you think was the cause of pericardial tamponade? Was it a leak from the graft or it is a injury to the...
They felt it was a venous bleeder, so they were they felt it was more likely to be a venous bleeder. They were also looking into terms of whether it was the coronary endarterectomy itself, but that looked to be okay. So eventually they felt it was the venous bleeder which was there.
In fact, this is true. If there is a Lima graft, the leakage from the graft is very rare. Only when it is a venous graft, the leakage is more common because of obvious reasons.
Yeah.
And the second possibility could have been dissection at the site of graft, particularly venous graft from the aorta. So that should also be kept in mind while thinking in terms of cardiogenic shock following CABG.
Good
message. Just one question, Satish. I think you mentioned about the compression of the RV, compression of the RA, compression of the LA. Is there any data that they see the compression of the LV also in this patient having cardiac tamponade post bypass surgery?
I do not have any sort of numbers, but when it comes to this particular patient, did not have any compression of LA. It was just the RA and RV. It was more anterior.
There are some reports.
I have 2 months back, I saw localized compression of the LV. This was along the posterior wall. Patient came with tamponade, but it is just as far as my experience is concerned, hardly any patients you see with LV compression, but the exact numbers data-wise, I really don't have. I can't remember.
But very important, just message, last concluding message. Any patient comes to you with a shock besides cardiac tamponade, what else we should think is a second or third important cause?
Well, the next is to look at just the pump failure. It's a poor inotropy. So one has to carefully assess the left ventricular function, and not just the left ventricular, even the RV function has to be assessed to look at any contractility issues. And the second message would be to look for any new regional wall motion abnormality.
Exactly. I could graft occlusion.
Yes.
Any comments or questions by any of the chairpersons? Any suggestions, concluding remarks?
No, that is true. If one have a cardiogenic shock or severe hypotension following CABG, three important causes should be looked into. One, a new regional wall motion abnormality, probably because of acute graft closure. Second is definitely pericardial effusion. And third may be dissection, either in the graft or in the aorta.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I am really very grateful to Dr. Anirudh Day for giving us this opportunity to interact on this very prestigious session, Clinic WACO. And I express on behalf of each and every chairperson my heartfelt gratitude to all the eminent speakers of the session. Thank you very much.